President of the University of Limerick, members of the Executive Board, members of the Governing Authority, colleagues of the university community, representatives and colleagues of other academic institutions and industry partners from Ireland, from the Netherlands, Brazil, UK, USA, and Switzerland. Family and friends, ladies and gentlemen, let's start with a little quiz. All that are against a better, healthy world, please raise your hand. And now all that favor a better, healthy world, now raise your hand. And all in favor of sustainable economic development, raise your hand as well. Thank you. On Tuesday, February 13th of this year, when arriving from the Netherlands at Cork Airport as one of UL's least sustainable airplane commuting professors, I read in the Dutch version of the Financial Times a column by Mark Blom. He is energy specialist of the law firm Nota Dulit. He made a strong plea against large-scale industrial carbon capture and storage. The central pillar of the new climate policy of the so-called third cabinet Rutte since mid-2017. This policy is a response to earlier financial incentives to stimulate hybrid cars in the Netherlands. Dutch taxpayers collectively financed 6.4 billion euros in incentives on hybrid cars such as the 1800 kilogram heavy Outlander, of which the majority has been claimed to hardly have used their electrical system. The incentives were used to upgrade towards a more luxury style car. The policy was called a massive failure by the current Minister of Economic Affairs, Erik Wiebes. The new policy focuses around a double size, 12 billion euro, tax incentives to promote storing carbon dioxide via expensive capture at an untested scale in empty gas fields without guarantee that it will stay there and for how long. The similarity in these close to 20 billion policies that both fail to bring sustainable economic development. That both support continued use of fossil energy while significantly hampering growth of renewable alternatives, and above all, both destroy economic value. Mark Blom has a legal background and is specialized in banking and securities litigation. He's a lawyer. And I, as an engineer, we both came to the same conclusions. Only partial solutions are being sought, resulting in short-term cosmetics that drain capital from structural investments in sustainable technologies and from integral systemic changes. Integral sustainable development towards a better, healthy world doesn't seem to be a target of the Dutch government. So what's wrong between those here, there, and us here? Why don't we just engineer and design a better, healthy world? In the next 15 minutes, I would like to discuss with you the why, how, and what of a more integral approach, what we call a systems approach, to sustainable economic development, for which most of you are in favor, as you just told me and each other. I will structure that via the three main targets on my wish list or planning as a Bernal Institute director: people and their career development, international context, and the role of diversity. The latter is to promote limitations of a narrow perspective held by a single, predominantly white male engineer line of thought and open the lens to more diverse views of technological and especially also non-technological options. This lecture of the coming 15 minutes is structured in three portions: setting the stage or exposition around people, a development around international and diversity, and then a recapitulation around people again. Very much a sonata form. I separated the sections by functional and hopefully enjoyable intermezzos because I think, just like you, that 50 minutes is a long stretch. People and BED. People. The Bernal Institute is at the University of Limerick and is created to support leadership in the field of materials and process engineering research in an Irish and global context. The driving force of the community rests in the motivation of its people. For many academics, this is rooted in their scientific conceptual thinking and is shaped by both large and programs and small projects, mostly in research, but increasingly used also as a bridge to education and design. For a growing part of the scientific community, the potential societal impact has also become a driving force, and in an Irish context, job creation and economic growth are continue to be prioritized, and so is the broader engagement. For instance, human health has become a central theme at this smoke-free, sports-oriented campus. Obviously, there are trade-offs between these impacts. Unbound economic growth and job stress compete with climate and health. Differences in value and culture will lead to debate and influence outcomes, and thereby set priorities in the development of the individual's career and the community as a whole. I'm pretty sure that those of you who are engineers or natural scientists follow this clockwise line of thought. This was typically the case at Delft University of Technology. However, those in social sciences and culture, a significant fraction of the campus community in this broad university, begins with values and ethics, follow an anti-clockwise line of thinking, often just accepting the economic parameters and perhaps see technology development as a necessary evil. Note that many politicians fall in this category as well. They are likely to create completely different solutions and technologies. And that is why diversity is so vital and was one of my motivations to come to Limerick while keeping the Delft link. Health is a central theme at UL, and the human biosystem, our body and psyche, as well. It is no surprise that this team also defines banal materials areas such as medical devices, biomaterials and pharmaceuticals. Importantly, this focus must regard a clean ecosystem and necessity for a healthy human as well. Materials areas such as clean energy conversion and storage and lightweight composite structures have a key role in supporting what I would call planetary health. With the increasing complexity of society and its underlying processes and information streams, we can't look away from ICT. Therefore, we have identified a body of work around electronics as well, although I would claim this is more the mandate of our sister institutes in Ireland, Tyndall at Cork, Crown at Trinity College in Dublin. Planetary health is a theme of increasing interest to me over the past 30 years. To underline its importance, I use the example of my good friend Eric Fernandez at World Bank. Shown is the global development of temperature anomalies with red zones increasingly above current averages and their impact on sea rise level. Climate and weather models predict increasing frequency in extreme heat, drought and rain. And the tragedy of the situation is that developing countries around the equator are hit first. For climate critics and skeptics, a 2 degrees C increase in your bodily temperature makes you extremely sick, and 4 degrees puts you in coma. The health of our planetary system is a serious issue. The nature of scientific research often brings an academic down to detail, sometimes extreme detail. There is a serious threat to forget about the impact on the integral system. Escher's waterfall has all details right, but the integral system is impossible to construct. Analyzing as a process engineer, work is performed continuously, although unclear what, already useful, there are no emissions, and the overall driving force lacks. Process engineers would qualify this as an open system, in which work can be performed, for instance, converting feedstocks into valuable products, and only if there is a continuous energy flux through the system, which is degraded from high quality, high temperature, high pressure, concentrated auxiliary materials to low qualities, low temperature, low pressure, and diluted. We also know how to calculate the minimum energy requirements, which in our terminology are called minimum work, and how that relates to the products that we want to produce. We also know that there is A, additional energy required to maintain such a process or system structure, and B, that there are materials and energy losses that purely relate to the productivity of such systems. These are two inherent aspects that are in general counteractive. The following schematic symbolizes distillation processes, which are the columns that are so visible in oil refineries and consume around 5% of global energy. At the left-hand side, we have a relatively simple setup with modest capital cost, CapEx, but significant energy loss, which leads to high operational expenditures, OPEX. At the right-hand side, we see a significantly more complex and expensive structure, but one that allows recycling of energy. Choosing between these two depends to some extent on technological detail, but mostly on societal values and culture, perceived investment risk, overall economics, emission regulations, incentives, corporate social responsibility, policy of the company, and so forth. Soft values are increasingly hard constraints for industries. A similar analysis can be applied to any open system. In my appointment at TU Delft, we dealt and continue to deal with industrial biotechnology for the production of chemicals, food ingredients, fuels and pharma products. Here, performance and maintenance of industrial microorganisms such as yeast for production of wine and beer also relate in cellular investment and metabolic operation cost profiles. This analysis can also be applied to human biosystems and essentially also to the ecology of the planet and thereby to my work, to the work of my friend Eric at the World Bank. It helps understand those from micro to mega scale. What we find is that evolution had ruthlessly selected systems that are optimal performers at a low energy cost, and the resulting systems have common structures. They work with platform molecules. Taking ourselves as an example, widely different bodily parts can be produced from a wide diversity of foods. These are first broken down to a limited number of platform metabolites, about 12, and then built into our organs, bones, muscles, skin, hair, and in some cases even brains. The structured system is about an order of magnitude more efficient in capital and operational costs relative to a non-structured system. With all respect that I have accumulated last year for J.D. Bernal, this is where he kept on struggling. As an eminent crystallographic scientist, he was so fascinated by structures only that, in my opinion, he never really managed to think as an engineer in terms of open systems and appreciate the role of driving forces, fluxes, and diversity. The notion about platforms came from many discussions with my distinguished and now emeritus colleague from Delft University, Seth Heine. I learned a lot from him and with him. Seth's original thinking started with industrial microorganisms, but we found that the principle can be scaled to industry sites and to complexes such as Rotterdam, Singapore and elsewhere, where we call it industrial ecology. That it can be scaled to society, where we call it sustainable economic development, and also to planetary health and its relation with climate. With this background, Patricia Ossewij, a social scientist of TU Delft, and I became involved in a 137-author group around UN Scientific Committee of Problems of the Environment, scope related to UNESCO, UNEP, and World Bank, led by Klaus Jasosa, Carlos de Brito Cruz, next, who was at the EQI conference in Dublin, and especially also Luciano Verdace, who was planned to be in Limerick at the 1st of March. I can compress my own career development in the last 30 years from pure technology focus towards a broader engaged scientist into a single slide, with activities of the bioprocess engineering group at TU Delft that I've been leading for the last 20 years. Current and past colleagues are shown, as well as the many industry partners, and not in the least by the public-private BBASIC organization for the last 15 years, represented or to be represented 1st of March by my colleagues, Managing Director Bram Brouwer, Sander Ransdorf as the cornerstone of the office, and the Chair of the Supervisory Board, Hemmer van Weghem. Fortunately, this is not a goodbye, but a good moment to say once more thank you to you all. I consider myself privileged to have worked and still working with this talented group and see that ideas are materializing in actual investment and operations, even to the level that it affects our own behaviors at TU Delft, symbolized by the new president of TU Delft, Tim van Hagen, at the left, and Peter Elbers, CEO of KLM, celebrating TU Delft become a member in KLM's corporate biofuels program to abate TU Delft's own emissions. And then, in this busy symphony, an unexpected call came from Ireland, and that brings us to intermezzo. International and BED. Until my 30s, my career was essentially rooted in the Netherlands, the international dimension restricted to incidental collaborations and conferences. The straight academic path in TU Delft changed significantly to include a second and much more international line. This started with engagement in the European Science Foundation, 1993, and the European Federation for Biotechnology, and a little later, 1997. The interaction started with my Brazilian colleagues, Professor Telmo Franco and Gustavo Paim of Unicamp. The European link resulted in engagement in the creation of the European Institute of Technology's Climate Kick through the fruitful collaboration with the colleagues at Imperial College, such as Richard Templer, Nilay Shah, Jeremy Woods, and later Mary Ritter, then Vice Rector and now member of Bernal Supervisory Board. Those have sent, apart from biologists, also their new star Roberto Rinaldi to the EcoBio Conference and originally also to Limerick. Thank you for attending and for participating in the seminar's discussion. Further expansion of networks came in 2004 through the BE Basic program. Successive appointments in the Philippines and Malaysia, and with the support of BE Basic Foundation, and a further professionalization of the Brazilian link, which, among others, an office was established at Unicamp, and a continued joint programs with FAPESP. These have been discussed at EcoBio Conference in Dublin with respect to the potential for renewed and intensified Irish-Brazilian contacts. A third, more commercial line arose during a sabbatical period at Royal Dutch Shell, arranged by Herman van Weghem in his global manager's role, which was and is participation in a number of clean tech startup companies. An ongoing hobby, since I believe that is how innovation fast-tracks to implementation. And later the engagement with the venture capital sector, represented by Janneke Bick, a senior partner at MBI Investors, song-related Rabobank, supposedly at the March 1 version of this lecture. This is a significant diversion of a professor's role. One can also call that distraction or lack of focus. Each of these three lines took about a third of my time. With some focus, one, my age index would have been three times higher, two, my budget would have been three times higher, and three, I would have been three times richer. But I also believe that I'm three times happier now. Anyhow, the call from Ireland in 2016. From the little information about Bernal available to me then, I figured out it was a sort of pharma institute. It brought back memories to an old love, since much of my earlier research was related to pharmaceuticals processing. As an example, we dealt various new reactor concepts for semi-synthetic antibiotics with DSM. We had a range of insulin projects with Novo Nordisk, monoclonal antibodies with Synthon and Biogen Heidek, and a continued line of activity with the Genzyme Corporation in Boston and Framingham, which is now actually Sanofi. As a student, I had a very early and inspiring interaction with Henri Termeer, actually also Dutch, the longest-serving CEO in that industry, then in their two-story Cambridge building. About 10 years later, and actually with Genzyme Transgenics, we developed continuous chromatography for protein purification to reduce capital requirements. All of that has led to a spin-out company by the name of Tarpan, acquired by Paul, where Mark Bischops designed and marketed the first disposable pharma-grade simulated moving bed unit. Henri Termeer had also the foresight to change the industry towards sustainability, achieving LEED ratings awards in building sustainability for the headquarters and science center. The first trips to Limerick were absolutely positive. I recognized the entrepreneurial mindset and ambitions of my alma mater, Twente University, including the campus life. After a few months of engagement and discussion with the family, who has said essentially, at least it is closer than Brazil and Malaysia, and we both said yes. There was a wedding present in the form of Ireland becoming the first country to fully divest from fossil fuels just days before my first working day. There must have been a relation between both events. Since that time, I have been part of the team that transfers the Bernal project towards the Bernal Institute. We have a leadership team, supervisory board in place, a strategy document that sets out directions, the core team of Joan, Sarah, Ornia, Vanula, Gordon and Thomas, the instrument scientist group, and since January this year, in close collaboration with John O'Halloran as general manager to streamline and discipline the organization, and maybe also myself. I'm privileged to be part of this new environment. The Banal Institute is centered around material areas that relate to the grand challenges in health, energy, transport, and to some extent also information technology, with a growing orientation towards process engineering. Not being a materials person myself, I learned a lot about the infrastructure and capabilities that we have available, as well as those that we are building and which we target to develop in the future. That next level, in my view, should be incorporate more automated, where possible, miniaturized, robotized experimentation to improve total productivity and potential accuracy. In the past decade, I have personally been engaged in this kind of activity for liquid handling systems, but I recognize it is a much larger challenge for solid materials within Bernal. And we have to develop equipment ourselves and or with partners. Second, to get ready for the big data handling. Modern microscopes such as Uschi Bangerts and Andy Stewart's Titan TEM bring the field from molecular stills to atomistic movies. This requires a full upgrade of the electron microscopy suites and answers to the resulting massive data flows, their storage and interpretation. Three. Increased models and use of models and modeling itself. In all project areas, models that are well calibrated on the massive data sets are absolutely necessary to help us detail insights while keeping systems oversight. The quality of modeling, helped by more powerful computers, can provide virtual insights into real observation and maybe even beyond real observations. We have visualized the last point with the help of our colleagues Eamon Curtis, a teacher at the Product Design College, and Peter Tiernan, our drone specialist, taking the Bernal Institute as an example. In the following combined movie animation, you can experience that the differences between recorded reality and simulated virtuality fade away. And as you can see, the model can even produce virtualities of a complete Bernal Institute's buildings. In reality, they're spread across the campus. Models are essential to help us to maintain oversight in complicated systems and biosystems that we wish to engineer and design. Let's summarize this on my wish list of planning and complete the first section as a Bernal Institute Director. Now, as Bernal Chair of Biosystems Engineering and Design, I do not plan to pursue much more lab or technical research in Limburg. Some of that remains in Delft, where much work is nearing completion, even as new programs start. With respect to the latter, Maria Cuellar and I recently started a collaboration with the Dutch Blood Bank, Sanquin, on the large-scale donor-free manufacturing of erythrocytes, red blood cells from stem cells. Here, very interesting links can be made for the stem cell work of the BioCyber Group in our biomaterials team. Continuous purification of biopharmaceuticals remains also a area close to my heart and links very well to the work of Luis Padrella, Denise Croker and others. I see significant BED opportunities at the interface of the various clusters within Bernal in relation to broader Irish and global challenges. I will indicate two. Number one deals with the increased work in the field of protein manufacturing, both dairy in DPTC and biopharma in SSPC and the related BioPoint and other facilities. With protein structure and function relations, again in the biomaterials area, the Mosaic Group, and our energy biomaterials clusters. The Mosaic Group had a big PR hit about producing piezoelectricity efficiently from cheap proteins and later from even cheaper glycine. Glycine is an amino acid widely available at the cost of several percent of conventional commercial piezoelectric materials at a superior performance. A project that we foresee, for which conducted back-of-the-envelope calculations with really interesting outcome, is to pave the M50 around Dublin with a glycine-based electricity harvesting system generated by the weight of the daily car commute. The plan is to start a further feasibility study this spring, also with students from TU Delft and from Limerick, and explore possibilities to develop this area into real success, or just reject it if it doesn't make sense. The second opportunity will come after the break, which is the intermezzo too. The network of people, projects and facilities is crucial, both locally and internationally. We have incorporated this in the website design of the Bernal Institute, produced by a spin-out company of the Computer Sciences Department of UL, coached by Michael Fernstrom. In what they call a Rhizoma tool, the dynamic network of interactions between the within the Institute is visualized as groups of spheres that represent people, in blue, and their clusters, in white, and projects, in red. Facilities and addition international network will be added in coming website versions. Selecting one makes it the center of the network that is then automatically reconfigured to show the network from the perspective of that person, the cluster, the project, and later also the facilities, and maybe international. In later stages, we'll expand this to our research partners elsewhere on the planet and make sure that Bernal and also UL increasingly becomes absorbed in the international network of scientists in our target areas. Diversity and BED. The decision of the Irish Parliament to fully divest fossil investments was probably stimulated by the following figure that states that Irish GDP per head is now ranking among the highest in Europe, and actually higher than Dutch GDP per head, and by the positive, or better, negative correlation between GDP per head capita and energy use and the related emissions per head. As the Bernal Institute has a broader mandate to support Irish sustainable economic development, we had to better connect sustainability to economic development. Our work in the pharma and biomedical areas provide but limited options for significant steps to emission reduction. But the work in the composite clusters and the energy and recycling cluster has very clear links. There are already fruitful collaborations with the wind industry that are linked to the continued electrification of the energy matrix. And we can envision how that links to homes, to industry, and to road transport. But the link is less clear for the agro sector and for long-haul transport. Aviation and shipping are critical for an island nation, and direct electrification is less evident. No less than 29% of emissions originate from agriculture, which seems at the first glance a very odd thing for the low-intensity Irish agriculture. Ireland is still predominantly known as a very green island with grazing sheep and cows. The picture is romantic, with very little cows per hectare, a quarter per hectare. Although in my belief they must feel very lonely, intensification would be an option with respect to farmer income and cow psychology. But the romantic picture is brutally disturbed by the very cow. Although the picture is deceiving, the digestion of grass in the cow's intestines is leading to methane gas, which is a two orders of magnitude more powerful greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide. Contrary to common belief, it is produced at the front end of the cow. It burps methane or biogas. This has inspired some pioneers to capture methane directly from cows. If you mount a bag on the right head end of the cow, you find indeed that the gas production ceases because you prevent the cow from eating altogether. Two cows producing methane, the equivalent of a single car's emission during a whole year. Recalculated, cows alone produce over 50% more greenhouse gas than the collective Irish car fleet. As a side note, aviation currently produces about 4% of Irish emissions, but this figure will triple towards 2050 with our current collective behaviors. And hiring commuting flying Dutchmen as Bernal professors doesn't make that any less. I'm probably the worst of all. I come back to aviation, but first let's continue the analysis of what I would call the cow's challenge. Cows produce milk and beef. Today, or actually we should have had 1st of March, at the Bernal Institute, a meeting of the Dairy Processing Technology Center. So I focus on beef today. Meat production continues 2.4 billion euros to the Irish economy, mostly via export. The associated methane production is 15 million tons of carbon dioxide equivalents per year, or 25% of total Irish emissions. So knowing that the gas capture is technically a challenge, people started to explore whether intervention in the cow digestion system is an option. A more or less successful project of DSM was to intervene in the two-stage gas digestion process in the stomachs and make the metabolites of the first step directly useful for cows. The results were impressive, 30% emission reduction at 10% more meat. The question now is how do these three methods, intensification, biogas capture and metabolic change, rank in emission reduction and in economic impact, and whether they are the best solutions anyhow. Our analysis so far only examined the conventional products from the agro sector. So that's beef, that's dairy, and now to some extent also biogas. Maybe we should zoom out to the larger economic system of Ireland, in which transport, and especially for the Shannon region, where also aviation finance, operations and maintenance already play a significant role. The Irish government has committed itself to the Global CORSIA Agreement, which aims to achieve carbon neutral growth from 2020 onward and reducing emissions by 50% in 2050 relative to the reference year of 2005. The figure gives the CORSIA target as the red star and the trajectory towards that target. The top line in the diagram of carbon emission versus years shows the non-change policy at historic numbers of roughly 5% increase per year, and the line directly below indicates the fraction taken by improved aircraft, lightweight by composites, and the rest is using sustainable biofuels. Maintenance and repair at Shannon offer the opportunity to replace continuously materials in and at the aircraft. For instance, the carpets are produced from nylon, which is the mostly fossil plastic with the highest emission per kilogram. This material looks like a protein. Well, you may follow my thinking. Collectively, with the Shannon Group and Sky Energy as the KLM spin-out for renewable biokerosene, we produced a white paper end of 2017 that indicates how Irish forestry residue that currently has no value can be converted into biofuels that absorb both the projected Irish biokerosene and part of diesel use, as well as bioplastic for potential use in wind and aviation sector. Putting all four scenarios in a perspective, it is clear that the diversified solution not only benefits the agricultural sector, but potentially boosts two completely new sectors for Ireland, for which the need is imminent: renewable fuels and composites. Greenhouse gas reduction and GDP impacts are superior. We need to dive in this deeper, and we will. The first project application called Aero Midwest, with regional and international partners, has been submitted. And I hope to have convinced you all of getting into BED. I can also update my wish list of plants. And there are more in the planning stage. There are also more methodologies behind this, but the key objective is bringing engineers and natural scientists, as well as non-engineers and social scientists together. And then we have gone a full circle both ways. The clockwise engineering way and the anti-clockwise way, starting with values, societal needs and culture. This is a good time to move back to people, to their values and the cultures again, zooming out from Ireland to the international scene. have gone a full circle and have come to people again, but now to compliment and to thank. First, I would like to thank the current president of the University of Limerick and his predecessor for the faith they have put in me, as well as the governing authority and the executive committee, especially Mary Shire and Edmund Magner, for the incredible opportunity and the continued support that you give me. I wish to compliment you for the courage to appoint a Dutch guy with this sort of background. I'm fully committed to contribute to Bernal in a dynamic manner, and I can promise you that there will never be a dull moment. That is also what I can promise to all of you, as my colleagues in the Bernal Institute and UL, who embedded me and my family so warmly. When dull moments kick in, and I'm not challenging you anymore, there's something wrong. I'm looking forward to work in the coming years with all of you. Christy, thank you for guiding much, but not all, of my Dunglish into English. And also a special word of thanks to Antoinette and Martin Fitzgerald, who provided so generously shelter in O'Brien's Bridge during the last year, with all of us waiting for my Fender solicitor to finally wake up. In a formal way, I would like to use the opportunity to thank the many, many organizations with whom we collaborated and are collaborating. Many of them are members of BBasic, so I use that list, as well as the list of Bernal Institute sponsors. I also would like to thank two persons in particular. Karl Luibe, the leaving rector of TU Delft, my former dean and my PhD advisor for the never-ending faith that at some point it would start making sense what I did, and gave me all freedom to fail, learn, and sometimes succeed. Kyle visited us here last year, shared some of his wisdom about career development, and has committed himself to assist us further. Kyle's not here today, since he is in the European Open Science Committee, appointed by the European Commission, that meets in Brussels. Second person is Gerda Louwens, my dear colleague and co-director of BBasic since 2004. We spent the first year in fierce fighting and managed then, in a very good collegial setting, the over 250 million BE Basic programs since 2010, also with Bram Brouwer and Herman van Weghem in the Netherlands and abroad. Gerda is also absent, since it is a little over a year ago that we had to say goodbye to her. Brain cancer still has hardly any cure. But she was actually the one who convinced me that coming here was the better choice. I also would like to thank the many colleagues at TU Delft, to the ones that planned to be present at the inaugural lecture in Limerick, Isabel Arends, head of Department of Biotechnology and director of the new Bioengineering Institute, Simon van der Zwaag, also a distinguished professor, but then in material science, very appropriate for Bernal, and Ellie Pau, heading the HR division, and actually hired me once upon a time at TU Delft as a professor. And for many, many others, I just give you some snapshots. And end with my dear friends, of which many are here specifically for the occasion, and for my dear family, for which words are not enough. Thank you.